Today we are here with Tim Silverwood, who is the ex-CEO and co-founder of Take 3 for the Sea and the co-founder of Ocean Impact Organization and also just a frothy surfer. So how are you, Tim?
I'm doing well, mate. I haven't got my saltwater therapy today yet. It's pretty flat down here on the northern beaches of Sydney, but I did get a couple of little waves yesterday, arvo.
Oh, nice. I actually went down to the beach yesterday, arvo, as well, but it was a bit blown out, so maybe I might actually head down and suss it out after we get off this call.
Good one. Need it.
Sweet, mate. Well, let's just get sucked straight into it. Firstly, I was just wanted to kind of frame the conversation and ask you, like, what's the real important, why is it so important for us to focus on the ocean and the health of the ocean?
I've been playing around a lot with some provocative messaging, particularly with Ocean Impact Organization, that starts with this simple lesson to everyone that we live on planet ocean. And I think that should be a bit humbling for everyone. And I'll go into it with a little bit more detail. So, of course, humans, we're very good at putting ourselves at the center of everything. So naturally, this concept of planet Earth, you know, we stand on the Earth and we really look predominantly at the terrestrial landmass that's on this planet. But it should be no big news to anyone that if you're looking at our planet from space, it's blue. It's 71% of the surface is blue. It's ocean. So when you then extrapolate that further and you start to look at the volume of water that's contained in the oceans and you start comparing that to land, it really starts to deepen that realization. So there's something like 500 times more volume of liquid in the ocean than there is of the gas in our atmosphere. So if you were to condense all the gases in our atmosphere, the air that we breathe right up to the start of space, that is a liquid would only be 1/500th of the volume of liquid in the ocean. And if you look at the terrestrial lands, so every bit of land that goes from the high tide line all the way to the top of Mount Everest, that is 1/11th of the volume of the space of the ocean. So there's far more habitable space in the ocean. It's where most life on the planet exists. It's where we came from. Yet for so long, humans have been very blind to the importance of that thriving, healthy ocean. So we've been taking from the ocean all that we want and dumping back all that we don't want. And so these scales are shifting. And so this juggernaut of declining ocean health is going to have massive and real consequences for our single species. And so for me, it's just a great way to engage humanity in this realization that we are not it. We are not everything. There's millions of other species that all coexist on this pale blue marble. And so by looking at the consequences we're having on the ocean and trying to tip the scales back to regenerate, to restore, to stop it from declining, to give it a chance to bounce back, I think is that humbling lesson that we all need to engage in just to get this concept of a sustainable existence embedded in people. So I love it. I think for me, it's just a whole wild new frontier to not just engage people, but to then unlock this treasure trove of opportunities that exist. First things first, we need to stop it health declining. And then we need to start looking at it. Well, it's not just a victim. I mean, it is a victim, but it's also a source of incredible opportunity. And that's mm-hmm. what I suppose the difference between all my work with Take 3 for the Sea, which is very much about saying, hey, everyone, hold your horses, stop, look at what we're doing. We're filling up the ocean with plastic and killing all these innocent creatures. Let's proactively address that problem. Now I'm looking at the ocean with Ocean Impact Organization and saying, my gosh, imagine what it would be like if we could breed a whole new generation of entrepreneurs and innovators to show that you can actually engage in good business for a good future. And in doing so, influence companies, governments, and masses of the community to go, right, I get it. We can have sustainability if we actually just do things a heck of a lot better than we have done in the past. So my first rant for the conversation there, Josh.
Yeah, wow. I love the emotion. Like, and I kind of, even just in that little piece there, I went on a bit of a journey. Like, as you started talking, I was you know, and about the kind of grand scale of the ocean, I had this kind of hopeful feeling come up. And then, you know, there was a little bit of like, oh, we're actually doing a lot of harm to that. And that's a big thing that we're harming. So that could be a problem. And then, but coming back to like the opportunities that we have, and, you know, that so many young people are working towards, and all people. Yeah, it's just really amazing. And it's like, I thought about how a lot of people actually live on the coast. Like a lot, I'm sure you probably would know this stat, but I don't know it off the top of my head. A lot of the population lives on the coast, whether that's in Australia or other countries. And, you know, I was thinking about how I went to the beach yesterday. Like most of the day I worked on the computer, and my kind of vision was straight into my computer. I went down to the beach, and that allowed me to just like open up my perspective and just go, whoa, and, you know, open up my view a little bit. And that just felt like a really healthy thing to do. So just moving into the next kind of question, how have you found that the ocean has actually helped your own personal health, like going down to the oceans, going down to the coastline and just opening up your perspective? Like, how has that helped you on your journey doing all of this kind of work?
Yeah, well, safe to say, like I'm one of those statistics you were referring to, where here in Australia, it is something like 90% of the population lives within 100 kilometres of the coast. And, you know, the 100 kilometres can still mean you're a long way from salt water and might not engage with it regularly. But that just goes to show that that other huge chunk of the country in the middle there is only really represented by sort of 10% of the population. So most Australians do have a relationship with the ocean and with the coastlines and estuaries. So for me, it's framed everything. You know, it's safe to say that I have no idea whether I would be a conservationist were it not for the ocean. I have my earliest memories all to do with the ocean. My formative years, coming of age with my friends and leaving the family nest to go and be adventurous was all about the ocean. It was about chasing waves, chasing experiences. Again, just this beautiful vulnerability that came from going into this wild frontier. I mentioned before that, you know, life on Earth came from the oceans and we came from the oceans, but it's not really our home. Like, we can't go out there and just throw ourselves into the ocean and survive. Like, we're done. We're done within hours, quite often. So it was an incredible experience to sort of play on that threshold of terrestrial and ocean environments. And yeah, it still is my absolute go-to. Like, I'm sitting here now and looking out my window, and I'm very fortunate to be able to see that the pit water on the northern beaches of Sydney, and it's being ruffled by about a 15 knot westerly at the moment. And then I've got the ocean just behind me, very close as well. So I can't imagine. I have had a couple of instances in my life where I've tried to live without the ocean close to me, and it's been tough, to be honest. So yeah, I definitely need the ocean, and I take it upon myself, therefore, to protect what I love so dearly. And in order to protect what I love, I have to go large, because, you know, it's wonderful when we all do our simple actions and do our best to preserve our patch. But when you look at the scale of the destruction, you have to go bigger, and you have to influence change at a mega level in order to be able to guarantee your own relationship with that healthy ocean, and not to mention the generations to come.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Like, when you're talking about that threshold of going, you know, as soon as any surfer would know this, and anyone else that enjoys the ocean, you go into the ocean, and if you spend enough time there, and if you're going out far enough, maybe people that aren't surfing, you go out behind the break and you sit there for a little while, you there's this instinct that comes up, which go, oh, like this is not my territory. And there's, you know, definitely it kicks in that different gear, doesn't it?
It really does.
Yeah.
And then obviously I had a really formative experience in 2011 where I'd never really fully engaged with open ocean sailing. Like, sure, I'd taken ferries from country to country here and there, being on the open ocean. But in 2011, sailing from Hawaii to Vancouver and spending 3 weeks on the open ocean and being thousands of kilometers from the nearest landmass, my gosh, talk about a humbling experience is getting out on the open ocean and being close and tactile and using the wind and navigating it. Man, I'll never forget that stuff.
Yeah, that's awesome. You also spoke a little bit about like the importance of doing, you know, the big important work And we can get into that. Before we get into that, though, I just am curious, like, if there's someone that is watching this that is a bit intimidated by that, you know, that massive kind of activism path and you know, really engaging change, and just, but still wants to do something. So let's talk about, like, what can we do on an individual level, on a small level, and then we'll move into some of the bigger solutions. So, like, you know, someone that's wanting to, is stepping into that role of, like, you know, caretaker of environment. What can they do?
Look, I think what we really want to see, and what I would really want to see, is people that just do their best without it being ridiculously onerous to embody the current state of affairs. I think this is really true of everything in the climate conservation and biodiversity collapse and all the regional problems that we face. Like, we're really looking for people to embody the sense of being custodians. And for me, that starts up here. It starts in your head. It starts with just a simple acknowledgement that the problems exist, and an acknowledgement that whether it feels good or not, you are part of the problem. I mean, we're labeled as consumers, as horrible as that is, and that's because everything we touch and interact with on a daily basis is made from something. It was probably made by someone, and it was made somewhere, and it was transported. So you have to just at least acknowledge that the problems exist, and that you have, you know, a role to play. And so therefore, every time you do something, even if it is one of those simple actions that are championed out there, and there's a lot of them, it's just to try and digest. It's plastic free July at the moment. Oh, I've got to do this, I've got to do that. It's dry July, or it's meat free Monday. So we have to take a lot on. But when we do that, we're just simply acknowledging the problem and playing our part in the solution. And if enough of us do that, and if we make it known, then suddenly we're saying, well, we're ready to be a consumer that wants to be on the better side of bad. Doesn't mean you're going to be perfect. Doesn't mean you're necessarily going to be good, but you're going to be better than bad. And that, to me, is so important, because that then shifts the whole market and the whole economic framework to saying, right, we all want to be doing better than what we have been doing, because it's pretty clear what we have been doing hasn't helped people, it hasn't helped planet, and it hasn't helped a lot of cultures who've been adversely impacted by our behavior.
Yeah, totally. And that is that, like, mindfulness piece, which I've been exploring a bit lately. It's been coming up a fair bit around, like, just, you know, taking that pause and just becoming a little bit mindful and going, like, is this what I want to be doing, or how can I do this better? And then two questions I heard recently were, like, you know, to kind of put to yourself before you take an action, you know, if I love myself, would I do this? Or if I love my environment, would I do this? And just, you know, just taking that, like, little bit of mindfulness before, you know, an action, and then going, okay, and ask yourself that question, and then just, you know, just see, like, allow a little bit of space to see what comes up from that. Someone told me that the other day, and I was like, wow, that's a powerful one.
It really is powerful. You know, one that I talk about a lot is just giving yourself, you know, when you're talking particularly about purchasing or consuming something, you know, where did it come from? You know, what are the impacts associated with the manufacture or the transportation of this goods? How does it feel for me to be, I suppose, the recipient of those impacts? Like, those impacts are sort of being justified because of me taking ownership of this service or this product. Mm. And then the last question is just simply, well, is there a way I could have the same service or product with a lesser impact? And if so, like, there's the decision right there. I should be championing that one, because I'm an agent of change and I'm an advocate. So therefore, I'll choose that one over that one, or I won't choose it at all.
Yeah, definitely. So good. And then, you know, as well, like, even further to that, moving beyond the self and, like, having those conversations with your community, your family and your friends, and then just, like, you know, engaging in a kind and considerate manner and asking those questions to other people as well, just acknowledging that, like, you don't have to take everything on yourself and have the whole weight of your everything on your shoulders. You can just have a conversation with a friend or your community and just, like, lighten that load a little bit by sharing. I think that's also another really important one.
Yeah, definitely. Probably something I could, even be a little bit better. And that's a really important sort of, I guess, point to hang on this is just that, you know, we don't, I hate hearing when people listen to environmentalists and or leaders and change agents and then get those sense of guilt and that really arduous responsibility. Like that, we don't really want that. Ideally, we want it to be as fun and simple and engaging and rewarding as possible, not onerous and painful.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, definitely. So embodying that, like you said in the beginning, is, you know, that healthy stuff comes through. Let's move on to like the bigger solutions. So we all know that we can all kind of, you know, do our part, and that's amazing. And as a community, like, we have such great power to do things together. But let's talk about like some of the really big, inspiring solutions that are happening at the moment and that you're aware of.
Yeah. So obviously, as I was saying before, my big focus now with OIO is to identify and support innovators and entrepreneurs who've got the big, great ideas that can help create a healthy and abundant ocean. So some that come to mind, like, I've just been doing a lot of obviously podcasting on my side, on the Ocean Impact podcast. And a few episodes ago, we had Sam Elsom, who's the co-founder and CEO of a project called Sea Forest. They're about 4 years old now. And Sam's kind of very similar to me, grew up in the Noosa area, and he just is a fashion designer and got the call to arms, like many of us, about the state of the climate, and started exploring the opportunities around seaweed. I think inspired by Tim Flannery, realizing that not only do we need to do everything we can to stop excess carbon pollution, but now we need to move into drawdown and sequestration of carbon. So got really fired up about seaweed as the solution for that. In the process, discovered this endemic seaweed species that only grows here in the southern part of Australia called Asparagopsis taxiforma, I think it's called. And it's this little red seaweed that's, you know, it's pretty inconspicuous when you see it. But through a bizarre quirk in nature, has these enzymes that when fed to rudiments, so cows and sheep and other livestock, it speeds up the productivity in one of their seven stomachs and stops vast amounts of carbon pollution coming out, like methane. So cows actually end up burping vast amounts of carbon, which I questioned Sam actually recently on this and said, like, why does that happen? Like, when nature always finds a way to be efficient and nature naturally hates waste, how has it become that livestock have just become so polluting? Because all that carbon is wasted energy. And you didn't have the answer for me, but maybe someone listening does. But anyway, cows,
like, because, sorry to butt in, but like, it makes sense. We've humans have like started to mass farm cows. So like, maybe that's the reason. Maybe it's just because we're interfering with the process by like mass farming all these cows. Like, maybe if there was just a natural amount of cows on the planet, then we'd be sweet. I don't know. That's,
yeah,
just,
and I guess the science would be looking back through the ages at the earliest forms of wild bovines and finding out whether they actually had any of this excessive carbon pollution as a result of their roaming behavior. Maybe their diet was diverse enough that the enzymes would have made their way into their system and it would have prevented that huge wastage of energy.
Yeah.
So anyway, he's found out that if you give these cows and sheep, it's like a handful of this seaweed in a day, and their methane is reduced by 98%. And it's just crazy, because not only is he sequestering carbon out of the oceans to help reduce ocean acidification and that carbonized ocean, he's also then reducing this carbon emissions from the livestock, from dairy. He's even working with wool providers. It's just gnarly.
Yeah.
So he just raised $34 million to scale his operation down in Tasmania. So congratulations to Sam. I mean, the other ones, you just got to go and look at the Ocean Impact Organization website and have a glimpse at some of the startups that we're supporting already. So last year we had an incredible renewable energy company called Waveswell Energy, where the guy is this brilliant mathematician, and he's had a very rich career and just turned into this incredible inventor, realized from interacting with the blowhole down at Kiama that the ocean waves colliding with a rock shelf that had an opening just created the most incredible force of energy and air moving through a blowhole. And he's like, I reckon there's a way of actually creating renewable energy from that. And so he's developed this thing, which is like a floating ferry with a cavity in the middle. And all it needs is tiny, like half a foot waves, not even. And the displacement of the air through this cavity spins a turbine and it creates renewable energy. So you just think about the ocean. It's always moving, be it tides or deep sea currents or waves. And there's our energy needs right there if we just change our lens and obviously figure out how to do the engineering piece to make it happen.
Yeah.
Gosh, how many other incredible innovations have we had? People that are looking at new ways of doing protein aquaculture. So instead of looking at aquaculture, which requires massive amounts of wild caught fish to feed fish in pens to then have these massive environmental burdens to get to the dinner plate. How can you do aquaculture differently? Like encouraging new diet of sea urchins that are an invasive species degrading kelp forests. What about if we actually took those sea urchins, fed them in an offshore or an onshore ranch, and then encouraged more people to eat seafood? It's uni, I think it's called.
Yeah.
You know, just things like that, just thinking outside the box. It's just been really inspiring.
Yeah. Yeah. Like when I hear about stuff like that, it just really does give me hope that there's so many people working towards these solutions. And even though, you look around at the moment, it's kind of like, oh, stuff, it's a bit rough, like what's going on at the moment. But, you know, when you know that there's just like people just dedicating their life to just like finding these solutions and then scaling them. And then you look at how far we've come over the last 50 or 100 years, it just kind of, and then you know that there's people working on this good stuff. Like it just gives you hope that, you know, another 50 years, hopefully we're moving towards a really healthy future.
Yeah, it does. And obviously you can't just sort of rest on your laurels and put all your eggs in that basket and say, we're going to innovate ourselves out of these problems. It's a multi-pronged attack. And it certainly starts with, you know, stopping the bad as quickly as possible, because some of the bad stuff that we're doing, it's just sending us so rapidly towards that wall. And then while you're slowing all that down, you can then start to sprinkle in all these new ways of doing things. And it's going to be a very strategic dance as we sort of navigate how we actually have a healthy, thriving Homo sapiens without the devastation that we've been causing in the last few centuries.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and on that kind of, let's go into your personal experience and the lessons that you've learned, through this journey, like what's been one of the biggest lessons for you personally?
I think, for me, it's sort of a word that's come up a couple of times in this conversation. It is about being humble and just a bit more cognizant and conscious. Like the thing that I spruik a lot at the moment is just this reinforcement that, you know, yes, of course I accept that Homo sapiens are going to put themselves at the center. That's probably, you know, that's a deeply embedded trait that maybe all species have, right? You know, I care about myself, the things that I need, my hierarchy of needs, I'm going to do that. But at the moment, it's pretty clear that we live on a very fragile blue marble. And over the last few hundred years, or you could probably look at it in the context of a lot longer, we've just been disrupting the stasis, the balance of this beautiful place. And the evidence is so powerful now that you have to just acknowledge that and be humble and say, right, okay, we can't keep doing it the way we've been doing it. Otherwise, in a very, and you know, every week there's more that comes out about just how rapidly it can accelerate if we let this runaway changes take place. So be humble, and therefore just to be, you know, committed that, you know, I've only got a very limited tenure in this weird little earth suit that I'm just so fortunate enough to exist within, to minimize my impact and encourage my brethren, my crew, to say, hey, we've had it pretty good. We've just evolved over the last few million years to get to this point. Don't you reckon it'd be nice if we at least let that continue for a bit longer without this ridiculous collateral damage that we're inflicting upon all the other species? Like, so there's a lot of sort of Zen sentiment within that. Like, just acknowledge we're not everything, guys. New shit's come to light. let's just navigate our way a bit more humbly moving forward.
For sure. Yeah, that's an awesome lesson to learn, and one that I think takes a little while to really like drop in. It's a journey towards that kind of humility. But I think that first step, like you said, is that awareness of like, okay, you know, we got it pretty good. It's been pretty good, but now it's, you know, things are looking a bit kind of, so like, how can we just, you know, change a few things in our life and in our community, and start to just like think about how we can do things a bit better and how we can stop doing all those things that are not so great. That's it, eh? So, and just a little bit further, so I'll just drop something else in. I was talking to a friend of ours recently, Sarah Rickards, and, you know, she's obviously a powerhouse in the kind of regenerative movement, and she's an amazing thinker. And, you know, she was touching on that kind of, that kind of spiritual aspect of regeneration as well. And it really is like that. It's got a depth to it, a specific kind of depth to it, this work that we're kind of engaged in. So I think it's also nice to just acknowledge that. And so I've got one more question, and that is, if you had one piece of advice for humanity at the moment, what would that be?
Treat the ocean with respect is the one that just sort of came up, and I know that's a big piece of advice and a bit too broad perhaps, but yeah, it's just where I can just totally see the remainder of my career and my tenure on this planet being, is to say, let's look at our future through the lens of the ocean. Because if we, as I said before, disrupt this juggernaut, which is the center of everything when it comes to this beautiful, stable climate that has just taken a long time to get to this beautiful little balance, and everything's just vibrating and humming, and then through our own negligence we just let those let it just sort of, you know, tip away, it just disrupts so much. So yeah, I really want to see a massive movement. I want the oceans to become, I mean, they already are through issues like plastic pollution and stuff, but super mainstream appreciation of the ocean, and that would obviously make me fulfilled and feel like I've got a lot of opportunity. But it would also be that, you know, it's central to what's going to help OIO do its best work, because ultimately what OIO should be judged upon in 5 or 10 years time is essentially how much money has been diverted from traditional investments in practices that cause harm into a whole new generation of practices and industries that are regenerative and restorative and are doing good. Mm. And only at that point can we really say, you know, we've succeeded. Because if the money keeps going to supporting the bad and that's where the returns are, then that's going to be where we're going to continue to head for many more years to come.
Yeah. Yeah, beautiful. Respect the ocean and vote with your dollar. And if anyone watching this wants to kind of learn more about OIO, it's Ocean Impact Organization. That's the company that Tim's doing some amazing work with. So you can go and check out Tim's Instagram, or which is Tim Silverwood, or Ocean Impact. It's got a cool little logo, which is just like a oi. so it's really catchy. But yeah, Ocean Impact Organization is where it's at. Good work, man. Thank you so much for giving me some of your time today.
Thanks, Josh. Appreciate it, mate.
Cheers, brother.